our call to worship. All souls, bless Yahweh. Yahweh our God, how great you are, beautifully, gloriously robed, dressed up in sunshine, and all heaven stretched out for your tent. You built your palace on the ocean deeps, made a chariot out of clouds, and took off on wind wings. You commanded winds as messengers, appointed fire and flame as ambassadors. You set earth on a firm foundation so that nothing can shake it ever. What a wildly wonderful world, Yahweh. You made it all with wisdom at your side, made earth overflow with your wonderful creations. Hallelujah. Praise God. Let us say our prayer of adoration. Holy One, before the wonder and power of your creative love, we offer our adoration, we welcome the silence. Enveloped by your wisdom and held by your grace, we offer our adoration, we welcome the silence. Challenged by your justice and sent by your spirit, we offer our adoration, we welcome the silence. In the name of Christ, we gather and pray. Amen. Our opening hymn is Praise the Lord, God's Glories Show. Please be seated. And hear the call to confession. Even the disciples, those closest to Jesus, get it wrong sometimes. They ask off-the-wall questions and frequently misunderstood Jesus' plans for the world and for them. But Jesus loves them still and trusts them with his companionship and his ministry. Trusting in a Savior who sees our human fumbling and still longs to be near us and shape us anew, let us come before God with the confessions of our hearts as we pray together, saying, Ever encouraging and hopeful God, we are mindful how raw ambition and unbridled competition not only cuts us off from you, but divides people from people. Sadly, it also hinders our own expressions of authenticity. We ask then that you help reshape our deepest desires, remolding them in the ways of self-giving, restating them in the words of compassion. For we know that your call to be great is not a call to be above and beyond all others. Rather, it is the fullness of love lived out in community, a daring to be all you have created us to be in service to you and one another. Grace us, please, in the being and doing, giving new insight and showing us less taken paths of renewed possibility. Amen. Please take a few moments for your own silent confession. Hear these words of assurance. The one who poured the foundations of creation fills us with grace and hope. The one who numbered the clouds tips the rain barrels of living water into our parched souls. The one who provides food for all living things feeds us with mercies which come fresh and new each day. Thanks be to God, we are forgiven. For a treat today, we have Patty Souter doing special music, My Redeemer is Faithful and True.
Thank you.
Thank you, Patty, and Joanna, too, for accompanying. Thank you so much. Okay. Do you mind if I turn this light on? Okay. All right. Thank you. Here is our prayer of illumination. So many times, O God, we come to you asking what we want, and you do not turn from us. Help us also to ask what you seek of us. May we be attentive to your answer in your word to us now. Amen. Our first reading is from the book of Job, chapter 38, verses 1 through 7, and then 34 through 41. Then the Lord answered Job out of the storm. He said, "Who is this that darkens my counsel with words without knowledge? Brace yourself like a man. I will question you, and you will answer me. Where were you when I laid the earth's foundation? Tell me if you understand. Who marked off its dimensions? Surely you know. Who stretched a measuring line across it? On what were its footings set, or who laid its cornerstone, while the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy?" Can you raise your voice to the clouds and cover yourself with a flood of water? Do you send the lightning bolts on their way? Do they report to you, "Here we are"? Who endowed the heart with wisdom or gave understanding to the mind? Who has the wisdom to count the clouds? Who can tip over the water jars of the heavens when the dust becomes hard and the clods of earth stick together? Do you hunt the prey for the lioness and satisfy the hunger of the lions when they crouch in their dens or lie in wait in a thicket? Who provides food for the raven when its young cry out to God and wander about for lack of food? This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Will you please join me in the responsive reading, which is taken from Psalm 104, verses 1 through 9 and 24. Praise the Lord, my soul. Lord, my God, you are very great. You are clothed with splendor and majesty. The Lord wraps himself in light as with a garment. He stretches out the heavens like a tent and lays the beams of his upper chambers on their waters. He makes the clouds his chariot and rides on the wings of the wind. He makes winds his messengers, flames of fire his servants. He set the earth on its foundations. It can never be moved. You covered it with the watery depths as with a garment. The waters stood above the mountains. But at your rebuke, the waters fled. At the sound of your thunder, they took to flight. They flowed over the mountains. They went deep into the valleys to the place you assigned for them. You set a boundary they cannot cross. Never again will they cover the earth. How many are your works, Lord? In wisdom you made them all. The earth is full of your creatures. Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Leanne. The reading we heard Anne first give was from Job. At that point in the book of Job, Job had it all and lost it all. The Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord, Job says. For 7 days after the worst has happened, Job's friends sit with him in silence. Then they break their silence to challenge him. He must have done something wrong. He must have sinned for all of this to have happened to him. It's what scholars, theologians call retributive justice. You get what you deserve. Job, though, maintains his integrity and will not give in to them just to fit their worldview. Bad things have happened, but he didn't cause or deserve them. He eventually appeals to God and feels like he can't find God. In his final defense, Job declares just how successful he has been, how respected and esteemed in the community. He enumerates just how righteously and blamelessly he had lived before it all fell apart. In the midst of three chapters full of questions, he lays it before God. Let God know my integrity. Oh, that I had one to hear me. Let the Almighty answer me. Pretty daring to make that demand of God. Well, God's answer is not what Job expects. It's what we just heard. God doesn't address Job's situation or any of those questions about justice. God can't be bothered with that whole long debate on retributive justice. And contrary to the expectations of Job's friends, there are no words of condemnation or chastisement for supposed sins that he has done. Instead, God challenges Job. Who is this that asks questions without knowledge? I'll ask the questions here, God says. From the center of the cyclone, God takes Job on a whirlwind tour of the cosmos, spending much time where the wild things are, describing all kinds of fierce and untamed creatures. Jesus and the disciples aren't on tour, but they are on the road. They've left Galilee behind, and Jerusalem and the cross are before them. Jesus' teaching and healing continue. So do conversations as they walk along, like this one. Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to Jesus. Teacher, they said, we want you to do for us whatever we ask. What do you want me to do for you? He asked. They replied, let one of us sit at your right and the other at your left in your glory. You don't know what you're asking, Jesus said. Can you drink the cup I drink or be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with? We can, they answered. Jesus said to them, well, you will drink the cup I drink and be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with. But to sit at my right or left is not for me to grant. These places belong to those for whom they have been prepared. When the 10 heard about this, they became indignant with James and John. Jesus called them together and said, you know that those who are regarded as rulers over the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant. And whoever wants to be first must be slaves of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Tis, 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 those sons of thunder. James and John are at it again. They're seeking greatness, demanding, did you hear that? Demanding the best seats in the house. Oy, those guys, you just want to roll your eyes at them. Here we go again. That jostling for position, that thrusting forward, the self-importance, the need to be noticed and escape invisibility. We're back to just a few weeks ago with the disciples contending for greatness, completely forgetting the importance of the least of these that Jesus had taught them. No, James and John are after the choice seats, the ones closest to Jesus, like the most honored guest at an Israelite feast. The other 10, when they hear about it, are quick to jump in. No fair! because, well, you know, they didn't think of it first. I'm sure I've shared with you before that I'm a West Wing fan of years gone by. In one of the earlier years, there was an episode where the president's staff is busy working out seating arrangements for a power breakfast between congressional leaders and the president. They move name cards around on a table, ever conscious of political pecking orders and who doesn't like whom, and balancing the table to give the appearance of bipartisanship, all these many, many factors, including somebody can't hear, so they have to be in a certain place. After 8 hours of all of this moving, thinking, planning, and reordering, they finally reach a workable arrangement. Whoa! They're so proud of themselves, with a table full and no conflicts. Then Toby, the communications director, saunters by. He glances at their achievement and observes, "There's just one problem. You left someone out." And they all stare and stare at the table, and Toby goes, "Wait for it." They stare at the table some more. And CJ Craig goes, "Guys, we forgot the president." What seats of honor do we want? People are funny. They want to sit in the back of the church, in the front of the plane, and in the middle of the road. And I got to tell you, driving down here from New York on the back roads, I worry about the ones in the middle of the road when I come around those curves. If you ever hear I'm in an accident, that's probably what happened. Sanctuaries like ours have the three royal chairs up front. One, two, three. Hopefully I got all them. The one behind me often looks like a throne. The one in the center often looks like a throne, matched by two smaller flanking chairs. The reason for them abounds, and I've heard many different ones. In one church in its long ago past, the throne seat was for the minister, and the two others were for the elders who served communion. In other more modern settings, the preacher sits in one side chair and the lay reader in the other, which is what we do, and the center chair is left open. One church says that they leave the center chair open because that's for Christ the King. Usually it's because of poor visibility. You sit back there and you can't see anybody in the congregation. And what I've learned about this one, it's uncomfortable. There are places of honor out among the pews, too, though. In some early American churches, pews were often boxed off and were paid for by the prominent families in the community, sort of like box seats in a theater. The more prestigious and wealthier families paid for the boxes closest to the pulpit. Go figure! If you didn't belong to the family whose name was on the door of the box, you couldn't sit there. And if you couldn't afford a box at all, you had to sit with a riffraff up in the balcony. Take a drive over to Bennington, Vermont sometime and visit Old First Church, and you'll see the boxes and the names and all of that. Now, while we've done away with box seats, and the balcony folks, if there are any, are not riffraff, some vestiges of the old system still linger. We may not have names on our pew, but we do tend to sit in the same places every Sunday, yes? I've been at many a nominating committee meeting at different churches where the members of the committee are discussing, you know, who to ask to serve on session, deacons, whatever, and they identify church members to one another by where they sit in the congregation. Somebody does it. Oh, yeah, remember they sit in the back behind so-and-so? And it works out pretty well, too. Despite the dividers in the pews that make our pews into little boxes, if you will, blessedly, our congregation is pretty good-natured about friends and visitors who may just sit in your pew. Please keep that. John and James seek the best seats, closest to Jesus, hoping his kingly glory might shine on them too. Unfortunately, they've completely misunderstood what Jesus' kingship will entail. Jesus just got done telling them as they travel down this road to Jerusalem, that he is going to his crucifixion to be beaten and mocked and abused along the way. When he gets there, those right and left-hand positions will be taken by two criminals on crosses of their own. Not exactly where you want to be. That's a little too close for comfort. What does it mean to be close to Jesus, to be close to God? The disciples thought, hey, it's a place of greatness. The criminals learned it can be a place of suffering. Job thought he could make demands of God. In an old hymn, it's depicted, there is a place of quiet rest near to the heart of God. You might notice we're not singing that one today. Jesus does offer us rest to us when we're weary and heavy burdened, but this isn't one of those times. Being close to Christ isn't always comfortable. If you want the seats of honor reserved for the leaders of the community, he tells his disciples and us, then you must act like a kingdom leader, which means a life of servanthood, putting others' comfort before your own, seeing that everyone else has a seat and is welcome in our fellowship. It means giving of your time, your abilities, your money, and yes, even your seat sometimes, so that all may come to know and experience God's love abundantly for them, given through Jesus Christ, his Son. With our sentient minds and opposable thumbs, humankind is pretty impressed with our greatness over the rest of creation. More and more, our Western culture is impressed with our own importance to the degree that our attitude has become one of entitlement. We deserve to be given our heart's desire, we think. We deserve to have cars and houses and riches and whatever else. We deserve to be treated with respect and deference. Yet the scriptures from both Mark and Job call us to rethink our positions in life relative to God. More than the servanthood Christ calls us to, we need to stand before the whirlwind like Job and be reminded of the awesome mystery and power that is God. There was a film years ago called The Bear. And in this one scene, the tiny bear cub stands on its hind legs to scare off an approaching cougar. The cougar becomes frightened, backs away, but not out of fear of the cub. Standing behind the little guy in exactly the same fierce position is a huge mama bear, ready to protect her cub from harm. Little bear is quite pleased with himself, thinking he got rid of the cougar, unaware of being shadowed and protected by one stronger and more powerful. When we feel all puffed up with our own importance, our little bear selves, wanting the best seats in the house, remember Job's reality check. God is God. We are not. In the loving and protective closeness of God, may we instead seek to serve and praise our great Creator. Amen. Amen. Our hymn is one that tells of the night before Jesus died and the great action he did with his disciples to show them how to live a servant life. It's Jesu, Jesu, number 367. We're singing verses 1-4.
Thank you.
declaring what we believe using words from the Confession of 1967, one of the confessions in our Book of Confessions. God's sovereign love is a mystery beyond the reach of the human mind. Human thought ascribes to God superlatives of power, wisdom, and goodness. But God reveals divine love in Jesus Christ by showing power in the form of a servant, wisdom in the folly of the cross, and goodness in receiving sinful men and women. The power of God's love in Christ to transform the world discloses that the Redeemer is the Lord and Creator who made all things to serve the purpose of God's love. Amen. You may be seated. Please join your hearts with me now in prayer. Holy God in three persons, we wonder at you, mighty enough to carve out the mountains, yet tender enough to be born as a baby, powerful enough to conquer death, but humble enough to pause by a well with an ostracized woman. We marvel at the complexities of you, and we long for you to show us the way. Show us, O God, how to use the bits of power that we have to break the chains of injustice. But teach us to do that without the misuse of influence and without the desire for personal glory. Help us find ourselves in your song, the one that rings out that whoever wishes to be great will be a servant to all. Holy God, it can be so hard to ask for help. We often worry about being a burden, and we know others often have needs bigger than our own. Help us to trust that we can come to you with the aches of our hearts for the world, our communities, our families, and ourselves. Give us the courage to share the journey with our fellow servants and to carry the load when we can and to allow others to support us when our legs wobble. Help us find ourselves in your song. God of light and life, there is so much strife in our world that it can be difficult to catch a glimpse of hope sometimes. We pray for all whose joy has been cast in shadow, those in the grips of depression and addiction, refugees with no safe place to call home, your children living with heavy medical news, caretakers in hospitals, public safety units and homes. We pray for all who long for relief and celebration. And we pray that you will show us how to tap into our creativity, our talents, our voices, and our time to do whatever we can to alleviate pain, extend compassion, and offer comfort. Help us find ourselves in your song. God in community, holy and one, in our hearts and with our lips, we pray as Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I want to thank you all again for the ways that you support the ministry that we are doing here at First Presbyterian. This month in particular, we're supporting the Chosen International Medical Assistance Program that provides medical equipment to people in need around the world. But your gifts also enable us to help people locally who are going through hard times and just need a little bit of help getting through. And it helps with those who are food insecure and have other needs in our community. So thank you for that. You know, we cannot give to God. We can only give back from what we've already received. Let us give back with a thankful heart and a generous spirit. Thank you. God of love, we know that all good things come from you. As we return these gifts to you, we pray that they will bring you joy. We pray that you will show us how to use them to serve you, your church, and your people, that you may be glorified. We pray this in the name of the one who modeled servant love for us, Jesus, our Christ. Amen. Our closing hymn, Lord Whose Love Through Humble Service, the words are on page 427 in the blue hymnal, but it's got a really weird tune there, so we're using the tune from 422, which is a bit more familiar. About your status or your favor, just go with God. Be assured that you are loved and highly favored. And may the grace of God, the love of Jesus, and the friendship of the Holy Spirit be with you, with those you love, and with those whom no one loves, this day and always. Amen. Amen.
worth faith.